At the outset, I'd like to congratulate Mr. Nitin Pai for his vision and his insight into giving us this platform to discuss coastal security. I'd also like to thank US Consulate for co-sponsoring this event. Now, India has had a maritime tradition stretching back several hundreds of years. Yet, we've always got a pain in the neck looking up at the north, at the land borders for our security, forgetting that it was those who came across the seas that colonized us. Sea blindness has been a major disease with us. The Mumbai blast of 1993 was a wake-up call. But as you're aware, we don't have a very strong institutional memory. So when 26/11 took place, we were not prepared. It was a truly humiliating experience, a traumatic experience. Are we any better today? Well, yes and no. And maybe in the course of the day, we can come to a conclusion. Now, Uri's been in the news lately, as you're aware. The Army and the BSF are on high alert. Fences have been electrified. But what about our coast? There are no fences. The sea is transnational in nature. Every point along the coast is the landing point. Now, what happened yesterday? I have a serious feeling it was engineered by Takshashila, what happened in Mumbai, to make our coastal security presentation very topical. So with that, I would like to get on with my presentation proper. Challenges in coastal security. Now, I'm sure you know the definition of coastal security. Nevertheless, for those, the younger lot who may not be familiar, subset of maritime security, border management, and internal security, protection of our coasts against asymmetric threats, non-state actors, etc. Now, the maritime area is large. I'm not looking at the EEZ, exclusive economic zone, extending up to 200 nautical miles from the coast and which may go up to 350 sometime in the future. It's about 2.01 million square kilometers. This, ladies and gentlemen, is slightly less than a total land mass. We have a parallel India at sea, and much happens there. What is the activity in the EEZ? Fishing vessels, dhows, merchant ships, naval and coast guard ships, extra-regional forces, oil production and exploration activities, you name it, the EEZ is a very active area. Most of the activities are legitimate, but there is scope for illegitimate activities, and that is what concerns us. So we have something called maritime domain awareness, where we have multi-layered array of platforms and sensors, be it aircraft, helicopters, UAVs, ships with their comment and inland facilities, coastal radar stations, shore-based comment, merchant ships, information sharing arrangements with our foreign country friends, friendly foreign countries. So what are we trying to do? We are trying to find out, give a situational awareness, tag everything that moves, like in the aviation world. Nothing flies without being identified. We want to make the seas transparent, translucent. This is a pictorial representation of various platform sensors for those who may not be very familiar, my younger friends. Now, threats and vulnerabilities are plenty, but I will concentrate just on a few. Now, International Ship and Port Security Code post 9/11, despite claims, no Indian port is really compliant. Ports like Mumbai leak like a sieve even today, so many years after 26/11. Waterfront security is the weak point. Acute oversight, a lack of oversight at a minor port, so we have plenty of them, 187. And the reports of this by our national agencies have appeared in the media very regularly, highlighting this lacuna. Container security initiative. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a ship with containers aboard. Now, yesterday I was reading that the largest ship, some Maersk something, carries 18,000 containers in one ship in one single trip. Now, that's a hell of a lot. Every day, thousands of containers enter our harbors. These are mostly Trojan horses, I'm not saying mostly, sorry, could be Trojan horses. Ports have a paucity of adequate X-ray machines, electronic devices. If I'm not mistaken, just JNPT has the required number of machines. 100-person screening is impossible, which would delay the economy. And then once you load a container ship, it's inaccessible. The tools of trade, perfect tools in the hands of a terrorist. I think here, humanity is key for us to put a finger on it. Fishing vessels, over 3 lakh fishing vessels in this country. A large number are unregistered, run by small families, mother and father. Now, radars and SIGINT may indicate a contact of interest, but identification is the key. What happened in 2611? There may be 1,000 ships along the coast, 1,000 fishing craft. Which is the one which has a terrorist? We don't know. Now, many years ago, I used to patrol the Park Bay in my ship called Kavrati from at Rameshwaram. You wouldn't believe, every evening, 800 boats used to go out from Rameshwaram across the IMBL into Sri Lanka. And we used to stand on the IMBL and try and regulate. Impossible task. Searching even a small vessel takes, you know, over half an hour. You know, when the ship is going up and down, the boat is going up and down, rough weather. So what we require here is a technological break to say, okay, this is where the terrorist is hiding, in which boat. Now, after 2611, a number of measures have been taken. You have the National Committee for Strengthening Maritime and Coastal Security. You have a three-tiered structure of the Navy, Coast Guard, and Marine Police. Then, of course, coastal police stations, Marine Police, surveillance radars, AIS, automatic identification system, VTMS, LRIT, a number of measures have come. Similarly, there are 4 joint operation centers, Mumbai, Visakhapatnam, Kochi, and Port Blair, manned by the Navy and Coast Guard. We have a National Command Control Communication Intelligence Facility in Gurgaon, opened, I think, a year or two ago. Sagar Prahari Bell for force protection of the naval and coast guard assets, compulsory registration of fishing vessels, issue of biometric cards to fishermen. There are various measures. They all will come together. Now, what is the jurisdiction at sea? In the inner circle, you have the, or let me start from the outside, you have the Navy beyond 200, the Coast Guard from 12 to 200, and the Marine Police up to 12. There are some minor variations. Currently, the Marine Police is patrolling up to 5 nautical miles, and Coast Guard is doing the balance because Marine Police has capacity and capability limitations. But this is the general picture of the layers. Now, post 2611, there have been delineation of duties. The Indian Navy has been designated as responsible for overall maritime security. Flag officers of the 3 commands have been designated as CNC Coastal Defense. The Director General, ICG, has been designated as Commander Coastal Command, that is responsible for coastal security and territorial waters, along with the Marine Police. And if we have some overlap, there is some room for confusion, but the Navy and Coast Guard are able to manage because we operate very closely. But the Navy often says, look, you've made us responsible, but where is the authority? Can I command the forces? I'm talking of the other forces, civil and maritime domain forces. So this is something which troubles us a lot. Now the Navy, see, unlike the US Coast Guard, which patrols the homeland, and the US Navies are worldwide in numbered fleet, 5th fleet, 6th fleet, 10th fleet, our Navy, Coast Guard, and Marine Police transit and operate in the same waters. Any threat coming from seaward may transit through the 3 layers from outside, or may just come into the inner layer, middle layer. So some opine that if a terrorist craft enters Marine Police layer after transiting through the other 2 layers, then who's responsible? Marine Police feels they're not responsible then. So we have a minor problem. Now we have a civil and maritime domain, Ministry of Shipping and Transport, DG Shipping and MMD, Port Authority, Shipyards, Customs. Now many of these people make laws, but do they have the capability to enforce it? Most of the writ runs only close to harbors. That's my view. So the Navy and Coast Guard put up a draft coastal security bill in 2013 to delineate the responsibilities of various agencies and for legal empowerment. But this is yet to be passed by the parliament, to the best of my knowledge. And look at the maritime stakeholders. We have a large number of stakeholders, but that's not the problem. The problem is of lack of a nodal agency Maritime governance, ladies and gentlemen, is the biggest problem, is the biggest challenge to coastal security. And look at these, MOD, MEA, MOST, etc. Right, now look at Ministry of Agriculture, looks after fisheries. It's an absolute insult to the fish in our waters. How can agriculture look after fisheries? Okay, these stakeholders were set up much before the coastal security gained the current importance and was optimized basically for land governance. Today, no single agency has overarching responsibility and authority to be a focal point. Organizations are headed or manned by generalist bureaucrats who are moving from one ministry to another and may not have seen the sea or a ship or been to sea or a ship. They lack maritime knowledge and may not be adept at technology. There are compartmentalization, lack of coordination, turf wars, reluctance to share information. Every agency wants authority, but no responsibility. So we have a land-centric approach to maritime and coastal security. We need to learn from the US, from the Homeland Security setup, that the Patriot Act of 2001, et cetera, to get everyone into line. Or do we require a separate cadre of security professionals in the civil services? Now, a federal structure creates problems of its own. We have 9 maritime states, 4 union territories. Not all states take coastal security very seriously because they don't understand the magnitude of the problem, the nature of threat. Some feel it's best handled by the center. Okay, some say we don't have enough funds. But the issue is a chain is as strong as the weakest link. So every state must have a certain threshold minimum for security. Some states are yet to set up maritime boards after several indicators by the central government. Field level, the organization is very top-heavy at Delhi, but runs out of steam at the states, district, and field level, which is actually the cutting edge of coastal security. The MMD, port staff, customs, marine police, they lack technical knowledge. Now, the marine police, one of the most important outcomes of 2611, is the last line of civil defense, and they, ladies and gentlemen, are the key to avoid and the 2611. But the takeoff level of personnel is very poor, unable to absorb technology. They lack a seafaring attitude. They consider sea duty boring, non-glamorous, seasickness, another issue. Okay, and most of them consider a punishment posting. In my talk, I've realized that. So primarily, and this is not because the policemen are bad, because they don't have a cadre. They're not trained. If they're trained, they'll be as good as the Navy or the Coast Guard. So I'm not blaming the post at all. They often complain of lack of adequate power, manpower. There are gaps in operational exploitation and maintenance of boats. I have worked with the Karnataka Coastal Police very closely. They're a bunch of good people, and I think we need to support them. The Navy and Coast Guard do impart training to Marine Police, but there's no dedicated cadre, as I said, and frequent transfers. So whatever the training value there, it dissipates. So we need to have these two academies were supposed to come up, one on each coast, set up by the center. I don't think it has come up. And despite problems, let me tell you, the Marine Police is doing the best they're doing a good job, actually. The National Committee for Strengthening Maritime and Coastal Security was set up after 2611, headed by the Cabinet Secretary. Meets once in 6 months, sometimes by teleconference. Now, 8 years after 2611, we still do not have a nodal agency. See, the Cabinet Secretary is not some ordinary officer. He has hundreds of committees. He has no time. And he requires a maritime expertise. So we have been talking maritime advisor, maritime advisory bodies. None is there. The present government, after taking over, said, we will set up a national maritime authority. Nowhere on the scene. So therefore, the Cabinet Secretary has to depend on some MHA guy, who may not have a full picture of the coast or the picture. Now, ex-servicemen, plenty, but the terms and conditions are bad, poor pay, problem of equivalency in ranks, lack of adequately 15 days in a month, in a year. They're engaged on contract basis for short periods. But some state governments are doing a good job in managing them. Some are not so proactive. Technology, ladies and gentlemen, is the force multiplier. But technology itself is a challenge, I feel. The Navy and Coast Guard are lucky. We have marine engineering branches, electrical branches, dockyards, user maintainer concept, so we are handling it well. But what about the other civil maritime agencies? That is the problem area. Now, the government has incurred a lot of expenditure on assets. It may be inadequate currently. But are we getting gains on investment? Technology is being lost at sea. Agents are not able to absorb, as I said. Is it economical for fishermen? Right? Are they user-friendly and maintenance not maintenance-intensive? The induction of a new equipment is the least of the problem. It is the continued operational and maintenance issues which will pose a problem in the long run, and soon you'll have boats secured alongside. Now, the Goa Shipyard and Gardnery, which manufactures these boats, and the AMC provider, they're all vendors. They want money. Okay. Further, most marine police stations are in remote areas. No workshop facilities, administrative and logistics support is not too good. And then, of course, jetties and stations are not co-located. Several problems. Where local marine engineering support is available, then you have problems of, you know, approvals, financial approvals, etc. So this is a picture of the 5-ton and 12-ton boats in harbor. Technical, what is it, 5 minutes? Okay. So the AMC providers, the AMC was set up between the MHA and private companies. The marine police was unfortunately not involved. Okay, so they're not able to leverage. I think the contracts needs redrafting based on experience, and consumables needs to be put on the AMC provider. There are other issues, fuel allowances low, engine hour restrictions, doesn't help the police. So what is the way ahead? A proactive and bottom-up approach is required in addition to top-down approach. Marine police require all the help they can get from the Navy, Coast Guard, government. I think the Coast Guard should be made responsible for marine police, training, operations, maintenance, logistics, etc. The Coast Guard is extremely capable. I have worked very closely with them. They will, of course, require a lot of augmentation, and charters can always be changed. And this talk of Central Marine Police Force, I think it's not a starter. Every time we want to add a new layer, new organization, I think the states are abdicating their responsibilities. They don't want to respond, so they say, okay, give it to the center, let them raise a Central Marine Police Force. I think if we are indulging in unnecessary layers of layers, and then expenditure. Now, the Coast Guard is currently under the MOD. It also has linkages with MHA. I think Coast Guard should be separately under the MHA and be made exclusive responsible for coastal security. The Navy should deal only with blue water, war fighting, nuclear deterrence, all those issues. And all states must have their own academy besides the two academies being set up by the center. We need to induct more personal fishermen community, give them a sea duty allowance to, you know, pop up the morale. And a technical officer from the Navy and Coast Guard must be appointed to the Marine Police to act as an advisor, interact the shipyard with the AMC provider. During monsoons, there is no patrolling because these crafts have limitations. So we need to hire maybe 40-ton boats being built in Mangalore and similar places. Look at greater private sector participation. All states need to set up maritime boats early. The coastal security bill needs to be passed soon. Information intelligence sharing with friendly foreign countries needs strengthening. And lastly, the counterterrorism structure in the country is police oriented. And we need induction naval and coast guard officers to give it an edge in maritime counterterrorism. A multidisciplinary national maritime authority needs to set up. They must be able to advise the NSA, advise the cabinet secretary. The cabinet secretary should be left to fend for himself depending on some MHA guy. What we want is a robust coastal security and maritime counterterrorism strategy set out by the NMA. Ladies and gentlemen, I have finished. Thank you. Very kind of you.